Welcome to the Bakersfield City Council meeting. This television broadcast is brought to you by the local cable companies, the County of Kern, and the City of Bakersfield. You can watch the rebroadcast of this meeting Saturday at 7 p.m., Sunday at 10 a.m., and the following Wednesday at 7 p.m. You can download the agenda for this meeting at www.bakersfieldcity.us. Presiding over this evening's meeting, the Honorable Karen Goh.
It's my pleasure to call to order the City Council meeting of January 4th, 2017. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mayor Goh.
Here.
Vice Mayor Smith.
I am here.
Councilmember Rivera.
Here.
Councilmember Gonzalez.
Here.
Councilmember Weir.
Here.
Councilmember Tack. I saw him earlier. Councilmember Sullivan.
Here.
And Councilmember Parlier.
Here.
Thank you. At this time, would you please stand for the invocation to be offered by Pastor Tari Tyler, and then remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
May we all bow our heads with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you as you've brought us out for this first gathering of the new year, as you place civic duties and political responsibilities upon this city. We ask for your grace this year that it be awesome, that this prayer initiates and ignites a fervent prayer that would be able to touch each and every individual part of this city and the council members and the families and the new transition of the mayor as well. We pray for grace and speed over this city at large, that the death toll will decrease, dear God, and we will begin to give you all the honor and glory. As your word says, that when the righteous are in place of authority, the people will rejoice. We thank you, dear God, for a season of rejoicing from now until the end of the year. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Welcome, everyone, and so glad to see all of you here, new council members, and we're glad to be here. So a few of us are rookies, and we'll give each other permission. If we need to learn, we'll learn. It's not a big deal. Here are a few guidelines to help our meeting run smoothly. We request you turn off your phones. Council members aren't allowed to send or receive electronic communications during the meeting, and we'd ask you to be courteous in the use of cameras and videos. Applause is allowed during the presentations portion of the meeting, but it isn't allowed at other times of the meeting. And for safety reasons and as a courtesy to others, we ask that no signs are allowed in the council chamber. So thank you so much for your cooperation. Madam Clerk, would you read the next item, please?
Thank you, Mayor. Before we begin, staff is recommending that the hearing item 10A be opened and continued to the February 15th City Council meeting. And our next item is a presentation of a proclamation to Mayor Fagan's, Michael Fagan's, Coordinator Kern Coalition Against Human Trafficking, declaring January 2017 Human Trafficking Awareness Month.
So Michael, we just made you mayor. So are you ready for the job?
There you go. It's yours.
You know, I wish we didn't have to do this proclamation, but I am so thankful that you and others who really care about our community, those who are so vulnerable and getting injured, really are being taken care of, and that you're advocating on their behalf. And so it's my honor to present this proclamation. Whereas human trafficking has become a modern-day version of slavery that exploits victims through coercion, forcing them to perform services for profit, including but not limited to commercial sex acts and various exploitations of labor. And whereas it's estimated that more than 20 million people, men, women, and children in all corners of the globe are victims of this deplorable practice. And the total number of victims in this country is projected to be in the hundreds of thousands. And whereas in 2015 alone, an estimated 1 out of 5 endangered runaways reported to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children were likely child sex trafficking victims. And whereas victims are isolated in order to hide the crime, and local citizens are largely unaware of the trafficking taking place in the community, and human trafficking exists and is prevalent in our Central Valley. And whereas the Fresno Economic Opportunities Commission Central Valley Against Human Trafficking Project, a collaboration of Central Valley coalitions, including Kern Coalition Against Human Trafficking, has identified and assisted over 400 victims of human trafficking from our local communities by providing valuable resources to empower self-sufficiency and restore dignity and support recovery from trauma, with over 130 victims of trafficking identified in 2016 alone. And whereas Human Trafficking Awareness Month highlights the plight of victims and encourages our citizens to be vigilant in reporting instances of human trafficking or suspected trafficking. Now, therefore, I, Karen Goh, Mayor of the City of Bakersfield, do hereby proclaim January 2017 as Human Trafficking Awareness Month in our city and call upon all citizens to support the obliteration of this dreadful crime in our community and all around the world. Dated Bakersfield, California, this fourth day of January 2017, and it's signed Mayor of the City of Bakersfield. So here we have the proclamation that I'd like to give you, and would you like to say a few words, Mr. Figgins? Thank you.
Madam Mayor and City Council members, particularly I'd like to point out that Vice Mayor Smith actually rode with us on the tour against trafficking. And wearing that hat for just a second, I'd also like to tell the city and the county that the tour against trafficking raised over $51,000 that were given to 10 organizations up and down the valley who are combating human trafficking and working with human trafficking survivors. I can also tell you that about 25,000 of that stayed in Kern County, because we have three remarkable organizations doing that work. So I wanted to report that back. I also want to say thank you specifically to the Bakersfield Police Department, who is one of our members of the coalition and does remarkable work with us. And I cannot say enough about their cooperation. They're working with the coalition. We also have the FBI, Homeland Security, Kern Sheriff's Department, Human Services, Probation, Mental Health, the list goes on. 50 plus organizations are part of our coalition, and we're one of the few not funded by the federal government or state government. This is a coalition that's come together around this issue. I also wanted to point out and thank Sandy Wu, who in partnership with the Alliance Against Family Violence, we now have a caseworker specifically designated to work with human trafficking in Kern County. And without that partnership between the Alliance and KCAT, we would not be able to have this remarkable lady working with us, but also for our community. The mayor has read the numbers that we have, and a slight update, at least here in Kern County. We've had 51 cases, 51 reported cases where we have offered services to survivors. Of that, 9 were labor cases, 35 were sex trafficking, and 3 were both. The number that is the hardest for me to talk about is we had 10 minors. Those are 10, and I want to say this, yes, I can say this, there were 10 young ladies who were taken advantage of and exploited for sex here in our county. And that is 10 too many, in my opinion. One of the other myths is that this is predominantly international people, and I can tell you that at least in Kern County, 38 of those cases were U.S. citizens. So this is U.S. citizens trafficking other U.S. citizens. We did have 13 foreign nationals who were in those cases, but once you look at even the Valley numbers, it's still essentially 3 to 1 where we have Americans trafficking other Americans. Yes, there are sex workers brought in. Yes, people go overseas to do sex trade, but it's happening here in our town. It's happening here in our city. Since 2010 to the current, we've had over 400 cases. 300 of them were domestic, only 100 were foreign. The youngest was 12, and the oldest was 72. So I would invite members of the council, and I know that we've extended this invitation to the mayor, to join us next Friday at the Liberty Bell at noon. That would be the 13th. And then we will also be screening the documentary, The Trafficked Life. We'll be doing that on Saturday the 14th at 7 p.m. at St. Paul's Episcopal Church. I've given my cards to the clerk and asked her to pass that out to the council, and I would sincerely ask that you and I have a conversation, or you and I and Sandy have a conversation in the next few months. The coalition is doing remarkable work. We're very thankful to the mayor and to the vice mayor for their support in these efforts. I think last time I was here, we talked about meeting up, council member, so I will extend an invitation again. I cannot thank you enough for the proclamation. I can promise you, what's remarkable about the coalition for me is that folks who are both liberal and conservative, who are both Christian and non-Christian, can come together and focus on this, because we believe that people should not be exploited in these ways. So thank you for your time, and thank you for the proclamation, and I can promise you that we will continue to do this work on behalf of the community. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Fagan, and the coalition. And if you haven't seen The Trafficked Life, I would encourage you to see that. It is very moving, and it will make a difference in your life. Thank you. Let's take a photo.
Okay. Should we get Sandy, too?
Oh, Sandy, come on up. All right, here we go. Next item, please.
Thank you, Mayor. We have our public statement portion at this time. This evening, we have 11 speakers, two on individual subjects, two on code enforcement, and seven regarding item 11A, the Target Zero.
At this time, we'll receive public statements. All statements are given a 3-minute time limit, 15 minutes per topic. If you have written comments that are longer than your verbal statements, give them to the clerk, please, and she'll give copies to the council. We just ask you to avoid any behavior that would disrupt the meeting. We're certainly interested and concerned with your issues, but because of the public notice requirement of the Brown Act, the council can't take any action when an item isn't on the agenda. The council can, however, refer your matter to committee or request that staff contact you. Madam Clerk, please call the first public speaker.
Thank you, Mayor. Our first speaker is Ryan Greenberg regarding religious inclusion.
Please come forward and... Please introduce yourself and go ahead.
Hi there. My name's Ryan Greenberg, otherwise known as Brother Brimstone. First of all, I would like to formally congratulate Mayor Goh on her ascent to the office of mayor, and I have full confidence you will faithfully execute its duties. Before approaching the dais this evening, I gave a public appearance announcing my intent to formally request that I be added to the invocation schedule so that I may lead the opening prayer as a representative of my religious order, the Satanic Temple. Having been involved with the temple a long time now, I had always thought it important that my faith be among those included in the process, but I wasn't always sure it was appropriate until I saw how willing you were to stand amongst people of diverse faith and stand for justice and righteousness. However, it wasn't until you won the election that I knew now was the time for bringing people together regardless of religious faith. Earlier today, I delivered a letter to the city, personally. It includes my formal written request, as well as the personal contact information necessary to follow up once you have an opening in the schedule available for me. I believe the way the process for scheduling religious leaders to perform this duty was previously handled by Harvey Hall's executive assistant, Keitha Turner, who would simply take down the relevant information of those interested and slot them in accordingly. It is my sincerest hope that by delivering a request in writing that this makes me compliant with whatever process that the mayor and her council has already set up. If not, I hope you'll utilize this moment as an opportunity to clarify the necessary process so that I may immediately be compliant. I'm looking forward to the opportunity to serve my community. I can already tell that the mayor, the council, and all those in attendance will be just as respectful of my presence as I am of every other religious orientation in governmental settings. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Greenberg. Thank you for your written comments, and go ahead and contact my office and we'll move ahead from there. Next speaker, please.
Our next speaker is Catherine Popplewell regarding trains near the courthouse.
Good evening. Go ahead and introduce yourself and go ahead.
My name is Catherine Popplewell, and I recently had an experience with the trains on L Street. I had contacted Jackie Sullivan, and I would like to address the trains that cross L Street just south of Truxton Avenue. I recently received a subpoena for court, and upon arrival, the north parking lot was completely full. I had to park south of the train tracks and waited on a train for approximately 20 minutes. It made me and a lot of other people late for court. Upon returning to my car after court, I waited an hour and a half. The train was blocking the street. This is not an acceptable amount of time. This was not an isolated incident, because the following week when I had to go back, the same exact thing happened. We desperately need an overpass or an underpass at this intersection. There is an overpass near Rabobank Arena, and I'm understanding that that was included when the arena was built, so that cost was absorbed by the arena. An underpass is also on Chester Avenue. Unfortunately, dress for court in high heels, and neither of these are an option, not to mention standing out in the rain, which seldom happens in Bakersfield, but it's happening now. Another solution may be a shuttle for the time being. I was able to speak to a lot of people while standing there for an hour and a half each day. And I was told they had also been late for court, and the judge did not care. He would forfeit the case on behalf of the other side, regardless of the circumstances. I'd like to also note that the jury services parking is also south of the train, and many of the people that were going to jury services were late for that event as well. As I stood there, I saw several people climb either under or over the train connections, which is highly dangerous. One man I spoke to said he had gotten a citation for it once, and it cost him $1,200. Nevertheless, he climbed over the train once again. Next time, it may cost him his life. It is a desperate situation that needs some immediate action. I understand after speaking to Nick Fiddler just a moment before the meeting that he has some valuable resources that might be able to be obtained and make some phone calls. I'm glad to help with any of that if I can do that for you. I hope you're able to find a reasonable solution to this ongoing problem.
Thank you, Ms. Popplewell. Next item, next public speaker.
Mayor.
Oh, I'm sorry. Councilmember Sullivan.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, thank you for coming with your comments. We addressed this issue a number of years ago, but of course things have changed since then. So I will appreciate a member of our staff perhaps giving us an update, the council members, and certainly getting in touch with Mrs. Popplewell. So, but thank you for bringing your issue to our attention. Thanks.
Thank you. Madam Clerk. Next public speaker.
Our next two are speaking on code enforcement. Our first speaker is Douglas Howard.
Please introduce yourself and go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Douglas Howard. I've been in Bakersfield for like 27 years, and I'm more proud of it than anything else, but my time has started. Mayor, my issues about code enforcement is that they choose and which codes that they want to enforce. I have contacted them several times on a code violation, which includes encroachments, City Code 1220.02, along with the 1708.175 clear line of sight. I contacted the office several times, and each time I have to go back. I allow them 2 weeks to do some kind of action, and each time I go back, they tell me they close the case because they don't want to do anything about it. So that tells me that they choose what codes that they want to enforce. This is a code on encroachments where the person has to fill out a form that the city has formatted, and there's a certain application which requires residential districts $300,000, commercial properties to have $1 million liability. And the reason why I'm insisting that this code be enforced, because every morning, due to some property line readjustments, it's a safety matter for my wife, and I'm in fear that there'll be an accident, which no amount of money can replace my wife for 37 years. And so I've contacted the supervisor, which was Neil Ward, and I found out that she has retired. And so I asked, well, who do I speak to next? I even came down to the office as of Tuesday and asked again. I spoke to the code officer once more, and he still told me that he was not going to close the case. Therefore, I asked, well, what my next step was, and that was to get my ward representative, which is Mr. Riviera. And I called him on Tuesday and emailed him in regards to this issue. The issue is that if there's no resolve of the issue, that it's going to be a dangerous situation for my wife. Code enforcement responded to a certain code, an example that they choose which code they want to enforce. That was a complaint of an object that was 2 feet by 4 feet against my curve. In less than a week, code enforcement had sent me a letter stating that I had 12 days to correct this issue. And so at that point, I noticed that this is a non-life-threatening issue versus a life-threatening issue. And I just wish that I can find the right steps to see that this violation be corrected in a timely manner. So I just, if you need to email all the facts, need to know who do I email these facts to. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Howard. Councilmember Parlier.
Thank you, Mayor. Director Kitchen, if we could have somebody from your department follow up with this gentleman, and if need be, maybe from the city attorney's office too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next public speaker.
Mr. Faustino Franco, regarding code enforcement.
Good evening. Please introduce yourself.
Good evening to all you guys. My name is Faustino Franco, and I came over here regarding Mr. Douglas Auer. So the situation happened 4 years ago when I let Mr. Douglas and his wife that I gonna build a fence. It was an old link fence, and I was gonna put a wood fence, a nice one, between both properties. So I start building the fence, the wood fence, and when I start building the fence, Mr. Hours, he told me, no, your property is 3 feet inside your property. And I told him, no, my property is right there in the old fence. And he said, no, you need to build in that side. So he don't let me build my fence no more. So I talked to his wife, and his wife told me, you know what, Mr. Franco, make a survey. So I paid $2,500 for a survey, and the survey was done. So the old fence was, his property got 1 foot in the back and 3 feet in the front. So his he built his driveway in my property. So he built his driveway in my property. So now I paid $2,500. I went to court, small claims. So they don't give me the $2,500. They tell me, you need to go to civil case, okay? So I paid for everything, right? So I got the survey, and now the judge gave me the order to build up my fence and cut the concrete. But they don't close the case because he was so aggressive. He was so aggressive, he hit my daughter in the face. And 2 weeks or maybe 3 weeks, in the 27th, I was driving on my car and he was walking in the street and he attacked me. He attacked me like this, ah! And then I ran my car and he hit the back of my car and he fell down on the floor and he started yelling, ah! He ran over me, he ran over me, and he make it look like an accident. So I got a police report right here too. And I got the court papers and everything. Every morning, I wake up and I see him in front of my house, measuring the property, taking pictures of my house. I'm scared because I fear for my family. I'm an oil field worker. I need to sleep so I can go the next day to work. And he always taking pictures, measuring it up.
And Mr. Franco, can you speak into the microphone, please?
Yeah, sorry.
Your time's almost up.
Yeah, and I feel fair for my life, for my wife, for my kids, because he already tried to make it look like an accident, something, and he always walking in front of my property. I'm scared for my kids. I'm scared for my life. And I see him in the street. I got to go around now because I don't know what he's going to do next.
Thank you, Mr. Franco. Your time is up. Can you bring your comments to a close?
Yeah, thank you, because I'm nervous and my English is not too good, but I wanted to come over here and let you guys know what's going on.
Thank you, Mr. Franco. Councilmember Parlier.
Thank you, Mayor. If staff could reach out to this gentleman, too, and see if we can resolve the issues. I sure appreciate it. Thank you. Or at least mitigate the issues. Thank you.
And we see Councilmember Rivera.
But did you have something to say?
Councilmember Parlier, through the mayor, staff made contact with the property owner today and will continue to investigate.
Thank you. Councilmember Rivera.
I'd like to have staff look into it as well, but you two need to figure this out on your own. It sounds rather childish to me to hear you both describe what is occurring, and I think you both can figure it out together. Staff will follow up, but you folks need to act like adults and figure this out, because I don't think it's necessary, and I don't think you need to get any more escalated than you already have. I'll return your call tomorrow. I apologize for not getting back to you today. And if you'd like to talk as well, you can call me or get my phone number from staff. But really, you guys need to figure this out.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next public speaker, please, Madam Clerk.
Mayor Goh, our next 7 speaker cards are all on the item 11A, Target Zero. Our first speaker is Liz Keogh.
We actually have a report in number 11. Would you prefer to reserve your comments together until after staff makes that report on Target Zero? Would that be helpful?
If council permits that, Mayor Goh, that's exactly what we'd like.
Okay, we'll do that. Thank you, Ms. Keogh.
Thank you very much.
And next item, please.
Our next item is appointment 7A, appointments to City Council committees and other special committees and boards by Vice Mayor Smith for the 2017-18 year.
Vice Mayor Smith.
Thank you, Mayor. I would move to adopt the council committees and appointments per the paper that I submitted in the agenda packet. I would check first to make sure all council members have seen that, I guess, and don't see anything else, so that's my motion.
We have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Councilmember Parlier has stepped away from the dais.
And the motion is unanimously approved with Councilmember Parlier absent.
Thank you. Vice Mayor?
Next item.
Our next appointment is one appointment to the Golden Empire Transit District Board due to the resignation of Elliot Kirschman, whose term will expire January 6, 2017. Applications were received from the following: Robert Neath, David Kinneman, and Carlos Bello. We do have ballots, and we will hand them to the Vice Mayor.
Vice Mayor, as the city clerk provides ballots to the council, I'd like to clarify the voting process for you. Although the council will use ballots, the outcome of the vote will be made public by the clerk. And based on these results, the council will then make the appropriate motion regarding each appointment. So following the council meeting, the individual ballots will be available for public review in the city clerk's office. Mayor and Council, the results of the tabulation are 6 votes for Council or for candidate Bello and 1 vote for candidate Kinnemeyer. Thank you, Vice Mayor.
I would move to appoint Mr. Bello to the Golden Empire Transit Board.
You have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Next item, please.
Our last item is two appointments to the Miscellaneous Civil Service Board due to a current vacancy by Gonzalo Ramirez and the expiration of term of Michael Caves, whose term expired December 31st, 2016. We received applications from Michael Caves and Karen Shaw.
Vice Mayor.
Thank you. I would move to appoint Michael Caves and Karen Shaw to the Miscellaneous Civil Service Board.
You have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Next item, please.
Consent calendar items 8A through 8AI.
Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Does any council member wish to recuse themselves from any items?
Yes, I do. And first and foremost, I want to apologize. I spent 20 years coming to the Planning Commission at 5:30, and I looked down. I was sitting in my car reading emails, and I am so sorry. I feel terrible. Ms. Kitchen can understand that one. Yes, I do. Councilmember Jeff Tack will abstain on one or more consent calendar agenda items. My vote to approve will only apply for the items which I have not abstained. I am abstaining from the following consent calendar items: agenda 8A, B, 1 and 2, 8 A, E, 1 and 2, 8 V, 2, and 8 V, 1. The proposed action affects the financial interest I have in an investment or business position I hold in waterways, which provides construction, water, and irrigation for some of the companies that I have conflicts with. Thank you, Vice Mayor.
Thank you. I don't have any cards for removal of consent calendar items. Does any council member wish to remove anything? There are none, so I make a motion to approve consent calendar items 8A through 8AI.
You have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Next item, please.
We have our hearing item next. And the hearing item is to consider a resolution making and findings and updating the capital improvement plan for the existing Metropolitan Bakersfield Habitat Conservation Plan. A finding that the project is exempt from CEQA will also be considered. Staff is recommending that this item be opened and continued to February 15th meeting. Those wishing to make comments regarding this item are welcome to do so. However, staff does prefer that the comments be held until the February 15th meeting.
Thank you. Before I open the public hearing, I'll go over the presentation time policy. Each side will be allowed 15 minutes. It's 15 minutes for all speakers. So it's important that you identify yourself quickly and make your statement so that others may speak. We'll hear statements from those opposed to the staff recommendation, then we'll hear from those who would like to speak in favor of the staff recommendation. If there's testimony on both sides, each side will be allowed a 5-minute rebuttal. There's a clock on the wall behind me, which indicates 15 minutes. And please step to the mic and identify yourself. After 14 minutes, a yellow light will come on. At the end of 15 minutes, a red light will flash, indicating your time is up and that we'd like you to quickly end your statement. You may ask questions during your statement, but they won't be answered until the public hearing is closed. If you have written comments that are longer than your verbal statement, please give them to the clerk and she'll provide copies to the council. We ask you to be courteous to others who wish to speak, and unless there's approval by the majority of the city council, there's a strict 15-minute time limit for all those in favor or in opposition to staff's recommendation. So we ask you to be concise and avoid repeating the remarks of the previous speakers. We're opening now the hearings. Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition? Seeing none, is there anyone who wishes to speak in support or in favor? Seeing none. Leave it open. And next, Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to make a motion to leave this hearing open and continue the matter to the February 15th City Council meeting.
Next item, please. Oh, sorry. There's a motion. Please cast your votes. I'll get this after a while.
We both will, Mayor.
Yeah, we will.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Thank you. Next item, please.
Our next item is an update on animal control activities and discussion regarding Target Zero program. We did receive email correspondence in support of the program from Rhonda Montgomery, Danny Spanks, Brandy Reed, Brianna Wilson, and Stacy Inns.
Thank you. Mr. Tandy.
Thank you, Mayor. Assistant City Manager Steve Tellier will make a PowerPoint presentation on this.
Good evening, Mayor Goh, members of the council. Steve Tellier, Assistant City Manager. It's my privilege to bring a presentation forward to you tonight that actually has had several rounds of discussion in your Legislative and Litigation Committee at the end of 2016. Just a little bit about sort of how this item came forward to you tonight. Again, the Legislative and Litigation Committee is a committee that has typically handled animal control related issues and will continue to do so at the request of the council in the future. As I mentioned, they held two meetings, one in August and one in October, where we were provided, or the committee was provided with this presentation, which provides an update of activities and happenings and things that we're doing related to animal control. And at the end of that discussion, the committee recommended that the full council be provided the presentation, which you're going to be hearing tonight. And then also they recommended some specific action, which I will get to at the end of the presentation. So just a little bit of an overview. The Animal Control Division of the City of Bakersfield is a division of the police department. It consists of two distinct components that work together. One is the field services component, which includes our animal control supervisor, Tammy Davis, a senior animal control officer, and several animal control officers, a clerk, and some temporary officers that we use for various activities. In addition to that, we also, for the last, 4 years now, have the operations of the City of Bakersfield Animal Care Center as part of the animal control activities. We have a unique relationship where we utilize a relationship with the SPCA to mainly staff and operate that facility. That includes 9 staff of the SPCA, including their veterinarian. We also have the Bakersfield Homeless Center that is a part of that collaboration, and they provide 11, or the equivalent of 11 staff, to help operate that facility. I'll talk a little bit more about the contributions of each. And the city has 2 distinct staff positions that are also housed and work out of the Animal Care Center. So field services, as I'm sure you all are aware, handles all the various calls throughout the city, the calls for service, whether there's a stray animal or a confined animal or perhaps an animal that might have gotten hit by a car or something to that effect. They will respond to all those types of calls, animal cruelty. In addition to that, they do quite a bit of proactive efforts and programs with the goal being to promote responsible pet ownership, to make sure that the public is aware of the various laws and requirements that are in place, to encourage vaccinations, licensing, getting animals identified with microchips. We've been doing a program since 2012 where we provide free microchips to city residents who have their animals or their dogs licensed. We've done over 6,000 of those since that time. We have other various programs, including our licensing clinics that we provide. Typically, we would do 1 a month at a various park. And then in addition to that, last year or so, we've been doing weekly clinics out at the Animal Care Center. We've had such great success with that that we're modifying how we're proceeding in the future with the monthly clinics. We're finding that people, it's easier for them to show up to the same facility on a weekly basis if they have follow-up shots or things of that nature they need to do. And so we're adjusting our monthly clinics accordingly, and we're going to about 5 next year, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. I wanted to talk about another component that has been sort of our proactive efforts. It's our spay and neuter voucher program. And you'll see that I'm representing Critters Without Litters up there because they're a key component to this program. The council has authorized over the last several fiscal years specific amounts of money that in total have reached upwards of over $100,000 towards assistance to get citizens assistance with spay or neutering their animals. To date, we have had over 2,000, just under 2,100 procedures that have been completed with that assistance and through Critters Without Litters. Again, we look to continue this allocation, I think, in future budget years because the demand and the success of this program has been evident. And you'll see that in some following numbers. With respect to the activities at CBAC, again, I mentioned that it's a partnership with the city, the SPCA, and the Bakersfield Homeless Center. That collaborative has resulted in a number of significant and positive changes to that facility. We undertook a major renovation, which included new construction of the facility. We have, I think, gone leaps and bounds to improve animal care at that facility. We've developed a lot of new relationships and improved the live release numbers, which directly relate to euthanasia, which is a prime concern of the community. I know this is a busy slide, but I'm going to highlight a few numbers. And just to orient you what this is a tracking document that I keep. And it's the information behind it is provided to me by Julie Johnson, who runs the Animal Control or the Animal Care Center. And on a monthly basis, I receive the information which is related to our intake. And just to kind of show you, in each sort of row here or series of rows is a year that we've been doing this. So you have year 1, year 2, year 3, and now we've gotten a quarter through year 4. And I will just show you real quickly. We started out with a live release rate just over 29% in our first year. We averaged that. And we've steadily made strides towards increasing that. And you've seen the next year we went up about 10%. Last year we concluded just right at 56%, And I will tell you right now, at a quarter into this year, we're at 63%. And we've had our highest month, I think, in our history this past month in December at 71%. And you'll see that the intake numbers that we're seeing are actually declining. The first year after we got established, the second year they kind of went up a little bit, and then they've been on the decline. And I track this pretty closely because I think this is a good indicator of some of the success that we're having. And again, just to emphasize, part of what we do is with the field, making sure that we try to reduce as many animals that come into that facility. But once they're in that facility, we want to make sure that we give them every opportunity to get out of that facility, either to adoption, return to an owner, or perhaps through rescue. To talk a little bit about the value of collaboration with the groups that we've been working with over the last several years, each one brings specific assets to the table. I think the city brought the resources for the renovation, the maintenance, the operational support, the support that our field team provides to the operations of CBAC. The homeless center has provided a very reliable, motivated, and economical labor force for us and the operations out there. And at the same time, it's had a dual bang for the buck, which is providing the citizens of the homeless center an opportunity to re-enter the workforce, to find that value in working for a living and using that as a stepping stone. We've got a number of people that have come through that program who've done it successfully. They've gone on to better jobs and to improve their circumstances for themselves and their families. And then, of course, the SPCA. You know, the SPCA several years ago did not have to take this challenge on, but they decided willingly to do that. We thought it was a natural partnership because they bring the expertise in shelter management and animal welfare far better than what we had at the time, and I think what was in place. And they've not only lived up to the agreement that we've had in place in terms of providing the service that we requested of them, but they've gone so much further, and they've brought a lot of added value and resources to that. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Just one example of that is, this is not something that was included in our agreement with the SPCA, but if any of you listen to the Scott Cox Show, you will know that Julie Johnson is a regular on the Scott Cox Show on Fridays, and she brings a pet of the week to the show. These are just pictures of some of the examples, and I think we have a 100% rate of the animals that have got on this show being adopted. And so it's been a good collaboration, a true added benefit that was not something that was part of the agreement. It's something that they've done because they've taken on this challenge and done it wholeheartedly. Additional added value. They've brought programs. SPCA and Julie have brought programs to this area, to the shelter. They've worked on collaborative efforts to get animals out through adoption programs and rescues. Some examples are the collaboration with Wounded Heroes for Pets for Vets. They've established relationship with a number of rescues that help get our animals out to, in many cases, parts of the country that are short animals. I know it's hard for us to believe that, but there are a number of areas of the country that actually are thirsty for animals. And through collaborations with entities like Wings of Rescue, we've been able to get over 6,000 animals out since 2013, almost 2,000 of them just with Wings of Rescue. And I thought it was worthy to put this in. This is a quote that was provided by Wings of Rescue, specifically about their experience and interaction with our Animal Care Center and the SPCA through that. Just a little bit more about some of the added benefits. The SPCA worked with the ASPCA to receive a grant for a transport van that is utilized at CBAC to help with some of the rescue efforts. They brought some programs in related to socializing shelter animals through some group play activities. There are some recent media relation efforts that Ms. Johnson has undertaken that actually resulted in a number of donations that we received to help bolster what we were doing with our surgical suite. You see a picture here where we have a vacant space. Now I'm happy to tell you that space is filled with a table that was donated to us and then outfitted with some contributions, generous contributions from the public that came from that calling on that through the media to receive that support, and it has now increased the efficiency and the ability of our vet to do a lot of the procedures in that suite. And then some other partnerships that have been established by the SPCA with BC, San Joaquin Valley College, and the Kern High School District as well, which have benefited not only those entities but also our facility. I'm going to highlight this because this is something that was relatively new, and it's something that I'm not generating. It was something that was generated by the Californian. This is an article that you may have seen on November 24th by James Berger. The title is Kern Cuts Euthanasia Rates in Half. Just to kind of, they had a little clever play on words as well. Let's give Kern a round of applause. Just some excerpts from that article that were included in there. County and city animal shelters make significant progress. The city and county kill rate has dropped by nearly half, but I think most importantly here, this is not a time to settle back and enjoy the progress that has been made. There's more to do. And I just want to pause and say that the efforts that have been made here are not just the city, not just the county. It is also Critters Without Litters. It is all the entities that have supported the movements and the programs that have led to this point, including those that are here tonight and some of the animal advocate groups and the volunteers that make a lot of our programs possible. So now I want to talk a little bit about moving forward. One of the things we highlighted in the committee was the use of technology. And I'm a big fan of GIS in the city. I think you've seen it used in a number of different applications. One that we're utilizing now is we're trying to take the data that we receive from the intake information into our facility, as well as the information we get from our calls for service from the field side, and we want to start mapping them so we can start to see where the issues are. Are we seeing concentrations in areas? We generally think we know, but the mapping really helps us, and it helps us marshal our resources to the areas where we think we get the biggest return. And so that's what we're doing with some of the clinics in the parks. We've tailored the schedule this coming year to focus on some of those high need areas, also include areas where we've had good turnout in the past. And so we're trying to take this data that's currently in generation. We're moving to a new program, shelter software management program, that's going to give us some of this data so we can complete this effort. But this is just an example of sort of moving forward and using some technology to assist us in being efficient with our resources. Another big component is the second half of this presentation, which is related to Target Zero. As I mentioned, you know, we've made great strides to get to where we are in the last several years. I think anybody who's been involved with monitoring or the animal control issues can see that. We're not where we need to be, but I think we've gone leaps and bounds from where we were prior to the last 3 or 4 years. With that, another sort of added benefit that the SPCA brought to bear was reaching out to a group called Target Zero, and specifically Dr. Sarah Pisano and Cameron Moore, who came out to Bakersfield at the request of the SPCA and basically did a little bit of an evaluation of our facility, talked with us about what we were doing, some of the programs we had in place, and offered the city to basically join that effort and become a fellow city and take advantage of some of the resources that they provide. Really what they are is they're an independent charitable organization that provides free mentoring, mentoring in best practices. Their goal is to get to a 90% plus live release rate. They provide organizational development effort or mentoring, community collaboration. And I think most importantly, because a lot of the people that are involved in animal control know a lot of the things that we should be doing or need to be doing or need to work towards, but one of the things that they potentially bring is a link to funding. And we're going through some tough economic times and we're trying to keep the progress going. And that link to funding, I think, is an important element of the Target Zero effort. So when they came out, they highlighted a lot of the positive aspects of what we have at CBAC, the collaboration with the entities that I've mentioned before, the refurbishment that we did, our surgical suite, a lot of the investments and programs that we've done. They highlighted the support that they have, that they clearly saw from the city council and the city management team. And they made various recommendations, and just a flavor of some of those are potentially expanding our shelter hours, modifying our cat adoption area and our housing for cats, expanding our volunteer programs and foster programs. And the one that's highlighted there, the community cat diversion program, was probably the single largest effort that they recommended. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what that means. Basically, that's a community cat diversion is a program that's designed to take animals that come into the shelter that are of a healthy body weight. They're probably free roamers. They're animals that come in that have a source of food, probably are owned in some capacity, might be cared for by a neighborhood. And instead of taking them into the shelter and having a very minimal chance of getting them returned home, because that's what we have with cats right now, the idea is to sterilize and vaccinate that animal, ear tip it, and then return it back to the area that it came. There's a lot of statistics and studies that they provide that show that this works. Animals, cats are 7 to 10 times more likely to find their way back to home or be adopted from the street than they are from the shelter. And this effort and this concept is a widely supported and I think implemented program in a lot of different places and by a lot of different entities, and especially the ones you see there. Other benefits, according to Target Zero, this program are it, again, returns the cats to the outdoor home where they have a known food source. It helps stop the reproduction cycle, the unwanted reproduction cycle, because you are spaying and neutering those animals. In their minds, it will drastically decrease our cat intake and euthanasia. Again, in the earlier slides, we're at about 30% to 35% of our population is cats, so this would help increase that live release rate even further. And they have a little bit of an ideal time turnaround schedule there that they commented on. So an effort like this or a program does require rollout, does require to inform staff and public and volunteers to make it happen. I think you will see probably by some of the speakers here that the volunteers are there. There's a lot of people that care a lot about animals in this community and are willing to help with efforts like this. I think there's general support. I've not heard anybody necessarily opposing this concept. That's supported by the second bullet that you see there. And I think that this will help show that we're making that next step and proceeding down a path to even further increase our live release numbers. So what are the next steps? Clearly, the Animal Control Division will continue to make strides towards decreasing intake and increasing live release. Those are the two keys. The SPCA has continued not only to do the many of the things that you saw in this presentation, but adding to that, they're currently out right now for a PetSmart's Charities Grant, which will support several spay and neuter programs, including community cat diversion, if we receive it. That's something that they're doing, again, because they're part of this effort. And then becoming a Target Zero Fellow City, I think, can bring the additional resources that we need to do some of these programs, especially when we're stretched thin right now with our available resources. So again, the Legislative and Litigation Committee heard these presentations, they heard the update, they heard sort of the next steps. After they heard that, they were strong in making a recommendation to the full council that the full council direct staff to move forward with the necessary actions to become a Target Zero Fellow City. So with that, I will take any questions, and again, the rest of the team who is really responsible for the success and their employees are here as well to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Would you like to call the public speakers?
Councilmember Parlier, do you want to wait? Okay, so this is the time now when we can move forward with those public speakers that were delayed earlier. Madam Clerk?
Thank you. Our first speaker will be Liz Keough.
So Ms. Keough and team, we know that there's only 15 minutes and you all care so much that it's easy to go over. So remember, it's only 3 minutes per speaker and 15 minutes total on the topic.
Gonna try to keep to that, Madam Chair. Congratulations, first of all, to you, to Councilmember Gonzalez, to Councilmember Tacht. As I think most of you know, I have been very active in animal welfare matters for many, many years, and it is delightful to know that the city is finally paying attention to the community cat problem. The discouraging part about this is that the benefits of the community cat diversion program have been known for at least a decade. All the information that LegLit received, some of what you've received tonight, show from Waco, from Jacksonville, from other cities. The discouraging part is that many of us animal welfare advocates have asked you, the council, have asked the city manager's office, have asked staff at CBAC to implement this program for 3 years. Our requests have fallen on deaf ears. It did not take Target Zero to come in and tell you how to run a program. Mr. Talia kindly referred to the fact that there are many of us in this community who know something about animal welfare and how to run programs. I would hope that in the coming months as the programs are being developed, that instead of running into the deafening silence when some of us have requests or ideas, that we would have a little bit more attention paid to what we would like to do. One of the things that I believe Mr. Talia also mentioned, and that was on the slide, is the need for volunteers. There is a need to involve the entire community. If the city wants to restrict the planning programming of these programs to city managers and CBAC, it's not going to happen. You have got to involve the community. You have got to do outreach. You all know where I stand. I appreciate your attention very much. Mr. Taylor is absolutely correct. There's a whole slew of us willing to work with you to make the city better for our animals. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Keough. Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Christy Nolan.
Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Thank you. My name is Christy Nolan. I'm a homeowner and a member of Kern County Animal Welfare Advocates. First, I'd like to congratulate you on your new post. You were newly sworn in yesterday, and I loved your speech. It was very inspiring, and I'm looking forward to uniting as one with the city. As you probably already know, we have an animal problem. I'm really excited about Target Zero coming in, but we have more problems than just that. So like Liz was just saying, please work with us. We have a huge pet overpopulation problem, which Target Zero is going to address. We also have the unhealthy feral and community cat population, which that is also addressing. People also treating dogs inhumanely in this town, and nobody does anything about it, such as chaining dogs to short chains and leaving them in the elements. It's against the law, but nobody does anything about it, even when there's pictures and proof, and we meet with you, and a month later we meet with you again, and nothing really happens, and nobody, we don't know where to turn. Help us know. Help us know where to turn. Also, we have a huge problem with dog fighting rings in this town, and nobody's doing anything about it. I don't understand that, and maybe you could help me understand. I don't know. We have many people in this city working hard to keep animals alive. The shelters are full, the rescues are full. People around town just helping out are full. I'm excited about the Target Zero program and looking forward to see what that happens with that, and also hopefully with what can happen with these other issues I brought up. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Nolan. Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Sandy Martinez.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Hi there. My name is actually Sundy Martineau. Okay. And it's kind of hard to, you know, I know you guys are kind of tired of hearing the same things over and over and over again, but I've been doing rescue for about 5 years now. I'm a realtor here in the town. I'm also a Bakersfield native. And I'm kind of more of an advocate for the pit bulls and on the kind of on the dog side there a little bit more. But one of the things I want to say about the Target Zero is that it's really going to help us unclog. You know, we're right now we're stuck with the shelters. They're not really able to be shelters. They're actually kill facilities. And we're trying to get, you know, more of a solution. We don't have a lot out there right now. So we have so many people who are finding dogs and they don't know what to do with them. As rescue groups such as myself and other people who are out there trying to do the best we can, we don't have any solutions right now. So we're really hoping the Target Zero program will help us kind of, you know, break through that, give us a little more, you know, some places to take the dogs so the owners can go there. Because right now we have so many animals in there. They're given a very small window of opportunity to get out. because we have so many that are coming in behind them that they're, you know, they're pushing them in there, and the other dogs that are already there, well, their time's up. We need the room. So that's kind of where we're at right now, and so we're really hoping that we'll have some more, you know, support this year, and I'll also be able to work together and kind of have a little bit more attention to the things that are needed out here. Like she had mentioned too with Christy, we have a lot of dog fighting, we have a lot of abuse, a lot of neglect, and these are things that people like myself, we're getting these messages on a daily basis, and nobody's answering, you know, our calls for help. Police aren't able to do anything about it. Animal control have their hands tied. Ordinances aren't being, you know, supported or enforced. So we're hoping for that to be kind of come about.
Thank you, Ms. Martineau. Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Barbara Stubblefield.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Hi. My name is Barbara Stubblefield. I've been rescuing independently for about 15 years. Dogs, cats, mice, whatever. Sent a whole load of guinea pigs to a rescue. There's no place. People drop their dogs. They dump their dogs, their cats, next door, around the corner, around the block, grocery center. Some of them don't want to take their animals to the shelter because in fear they're going to get killed, because we have a high kill facility. I don't know if you remember the front page several years ago, 10 or 12 years ago, with all the dead dogs and the 55-gallon drums. We've come a long way from that, but we still have a long way to go. I would like to see Target Zero become an active part of our community. We need them. We're not getting any help anywhere else, and I'm understanding they're there to help us. I also would like to suggest or say something. I don't know, the State Board of Equalization, I believe, handles the sales taxes. You take a Labradoodle person who is backyard breeding, is what I'm going to call it, because they have a designer dog, and they get 11 puppies, and I know this for a fact, and they sold them for $1,900 a piece 10 years ago. Same person is selling those same dogs, can't get rid of them, so now she's in a parking lot at an Albertsons with four dogs that are about 5 months old, trying to offload them for $50. Now, I want to back up a second. That $1,900 times 11 puppies, and that's one litter. A dog has two a year. That is over $20,000. She's making more money than a lot of our citizens are, and she's not paying any sales tax. So I think maybe we need to also look into the licensing of people that are breeding their animals and selling them on the Bakersfield, California, what have you. That might stop some of our overpopulation. Anyway, love to see what you guys can do for us. Please, please, we're begging you. There's a lot of us out there. A lot of us aren't here tonight because they're working. Some of them are out there trying to chase animals. Not chase them. I sat in a field for 3 months trying to catch a dog. It's just what we do, and we don't want to see them dead. We don't want to see the cats going into the youth, be euthanized, because when they come in, they don't easily come out. And a cat is a little different than a dog. They will become feral in an instant, just in a few matter of seconds, because they're in with another cat that's not from their colony, and they start, you know, hissing at each other and fighting. And if you don't get your cat right away, and it does go into a shelter, and it goes into that cat pen, it's going to be feral. So, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stubblefield. We have three speakers still and just under 5 minutes. So, if you want to accommodate each other, Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Brandy Reed.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you. My name is Brandy Reed, and I moved here about 3.5 years ago, and I have to say that I've never, in all the cities I've lived in, from San Diego to LA, I have never experienced such, so many animal abuse acts in this one city. And I actually started to get into rescuing about 1.5 years ago because this really touched me. Everything that was going on with all of the backyard breeding and the dogs being dumped and the euthanasia rate, it's moved me to actually start my own rescue and my own 501c. And I'm here today to express my concern for that and to be supportive towards Target Zero, because I really think that's going to be a great push to make the euthanasia rate less and to make pretty much this city and county a better place for animals. And excuse me, I'm a little nervous.
It's okay, we all get nervous.
Speaking, but,
no problem.
But being here and rescuing as many animals as I have within the year and a half, I've never rescued so many in such a small amount of time. So it tells me that there is a problem, there's an epidemic. And there needs to be something done with the backyard breeders that are happening, just like it's been discussed, and the euthanasia rates, and trying to get more volunteers and fosters. And there are people out there, there's just not enough communication for these people to volunteer. I have to tell you that I've tried to volunteer to the shelters several times. I filled out applications, and I never got called back. And that's a problem, you know, because there's people out there wanting to help, but yet no one's responding. And there could be so many more animals being saved. So if you can consider Target Zero coming in and then just hearing us out and promoting more communication for us, that would really be great.
Thank you, Ms.
Thank
Reed.
Thank you for hearing me.
We have about 2 minutes left and two speakers. So, Madam Clerk, please call the next speaker.
Helen Katowski.
Hi. In the interest of time, can I just say I agree with everybody and let the next person speak?
Sure. Next speaker, please.
Christina Highwood.
Hi, my name is Christina Hayworth, and my passion happens to be pit bulls. I'm going to make this really quick. I'm doing this on behalf of my beautiful pits, Rosie and Mackenzie. I actually picked up one of them where I saw someone drop her off in my alley. So I'm hoping that with Target Zero, that's just a step, because we need help. Because without my babies, I would be dead, because right now I'm very ill. And they're part of our family. So just listen to us, because all we want to do is help. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hayworth. Madam Clerk, is that the last speaker? Thank you. Councilmember Parlier.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, I want to start with a few of the comments that were made. Christy, you brought up dog fighting, and there was a couple other comments regarding neglect and abuse. If you have any specific information, please provide it to the police department. I'm sure they'll investigate. I've been on Legend Lit for 2 years. And, you know, the committee's dealt with this issue. You know, we helped with vouchers, and now we're talking about Target Zero. With CBAC, SBCA, Critters Without Litters, Liz, you know, all the support that you provide the committees to, and all your ideas, you know, it continues to grow. It's kind of been baby steps as we've gone along, but every time a new topic comes up, you know, may not be immediate, but I think we're open to your ideas, and just like Target Zero. And I look at this as just another opportunity to further those goals and to help support you, the community, help support CBAC, SPCA, and any other good ideas you have, just keep them coming. And I'd like to move this item. Thank you.
Thank you. Is that a motion, Councilmember Parlier?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
You have a motion, please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved with Councilmember Gonzalez absent.
Thank you. Next item, please.
Council and Mayor statements.
Is there any council member who would like to make a statement? Councilmember Smith, Vice Mayor Smith.
Thank you, Mayor. First, welcome, Mayor, and it's great having the first meeting with you, and I'm sure it's going to be a great few years. And thanks for being here. And just the other item, the downtown lights down Chester and at Robo Bank Arena and on the City Hall South and North, I think added a lot to the holiday. And I want to thank Councilmember Sullivan. I know she pushed that for a long time, and it really does show community pride and contributes to the downtown area. And I appreciate her work on that. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Sullivan.
Yes, thank you. Well, I love, like I've said many times, I love the beginning of every new year. It's exciting, but I feel real good about let me first say, appreciate the service of our mayor, our wonderful Mayor Hall, and the council members that are no longer with us. Appreciate their contribution and their effort, but I feel wonderful about this new group. You know, we expect our independence, and when we have an opinion, we expect it to be made known. But through the years, we've had a knack of continuing on. Sometimes there have been very strong differences of opinion on different issues, but even then, we have been able to go on and continue to be part of that present team. But this is our first meeting of 2017, and welcome, Mayor Goh. I mentioned to you one time, well, the bar has been set high. And you said, well, what do you mean by that? And it really caught me a little bit by surprise, and so I had to really put into words what I did mean by that. And yes, it has been high the last years, which is a good thing. But you already, we just have a kinder, it's very kind and smart, tough, involved, hands-on type style that you have already, that you've already shown our city. And of course, the two new council members is wonderful. We're going to have our differences, but we'll expect that. But at the same time, there's already a feeling of camaraderie, and even though we are different and represent different parts of town, of course, we're a team already, and we'll always work as a team for the betterment and good of our city. And I think we each one already feel that, know that to be the case. So Pam McCarthy, thank you for being able to fill in. Oh boy, Roberta, she was a dream, a doll. we were so lucky to have her as our city clerk as long as we did. But how lucky we are to have you back, Pam, until we can get our permanent new city clerk. And I know we're working on that right now, and there will be thought, work, prayer going into the selection. And I know we're going to end up for the perfect right replacement for what we have had, and be a long-term team member for our city. So that will be very interesting, and we'll all be looking forward to that very thoughtful, very, very important, very thoughtful choice that will be made. So let me quickly look at my notes here. Yes, so covered everything. And it's going to be, I appreciate being reelected again. And I am thrilled at the thought of a new term. And just, and I was thinking today that it seems like we are definitely, I mean, seldom are there the major changes to our city government that we are reflecting for this first meeting, a mayor and two new council members. That's huge and very special. And so we always expect and intend changes to be the best yet. So this is a new era that we're starting, and again, we're going to expect this to be another best yet era for our city. And so I'm thankful and delighted to be part of it, and just look forward to us working together for the next 2 years. We can guarantee that, and hopefully it'll be much longer than that. And I just feel good about this year and what we have to look forward to working together for the betterment of our city. So
thank you. Councilmember Parlier.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, I'd like to start out 2017 with a couple committee referrals. First one, I'd like an update to Legend Lit regarding the administrative process on firework enforcement from the fire department. The second one is to Safe Neighborhoods, and I'd like the police department to kind of give us a general briefing on the school resource officer program, how that works, who we partner with, the various school districts. And lastly, on Christmas Eve, actually midnight shift on Christmas Eve, I went for a ride-along with the Bakersfield Police Department. And it was kind of a surprise. It was a last-minute thing, and I called a watch commander, and an hour later I was in a patrol car and a very rainy night. But I will say that every officer I came in contact with that night was extremely professional, not only with myself, but with the public. They took a suspected drunk driver off the street, looked for somebody else in need that was probably a result of drunk driving that left the scene. But again, the courteous nature of the officers that I saw with the Bakersfield Police Department, I was highly impressed. And with that, I bid you good night. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilmember Gonzalez.
Thank you, Mayor Goh. I want to begin by joining my colleagues in congratulating you on your new position. Last night was a wonderful celebration. It was an important one, I believe, for our community, for us to collectively install our new mayor and to celebrate the city leadership. And so congratulations, and I look forward to working with you over the next 4 years. I also want to thank all of the city staff and department heads for welcoming me to the city. I've had a wonderful opportunity getting to know all of you, and I really appreciate the time, not only meeting with me, but preparing for our meetings throughout the past month. In fact, just yesterday, the city manager and Mr. Fidler and a few others had an opportunity to take a field trip and take a little tour around Ward 2. And I was very pleased with that opportunity and to really get into the weeds, literally, to discuss many of the issues facing some of our neighborhoods. And so, again, thank you to all the staff. I'm really impressed with the whole team throughout the organization. I believe that they sincerely want to do the best for our community, and I look forward to working with all of you over the next 4 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Well, it's my turn. Thank you all so much for coming out, for caring about our community, and voicing your suggestions and concerns. We really appreciate that. I look forward to working together with the council members. Welcome, Councilmember Tack and Gonzalez. Thank you, team, for all of the work that you put in, staff. And I look forward to working together as one. Last night, I highlighted our motto down here, out of many, one. And we may bring different perspectives, different strengths, but as we unite our hearts for the good of our community in really caring about our community, we can really accomplish a lot. So Happy New Year. Thank you all. And if there is nothing else, we stand adjourned at 6:39.